Sanatana Dharma is all about training. It's all about rehabilitating. It's all about evolving. And Sanatana Dharma approaches this in a most practical way. In many scriptures, you will find frameworks to identify where you are and how to grow from there. And so we're clear about this. I'll give you one example. Let's take up comparing from the perspective of the gunas. How does a tamasic person compare themselves? What is their relationship with comparisons? They don't compare. They're just too lazy. They're too lazy to even look around at anyone. They're sleeping most of the time. And the example of that is Kumbhakarna. Kumbhakarna is too lazy to be compared by or compared to. How does a Rajasic person use comparison? They keep looking around at others, often feeling superior, but finally feeling inferior. When Ravana went to kidnap, who's an example of Rajas, kidnap Mother Sita, he went in like a scared dog. Now, I was jogging the other day, and I was scared of the dog, but then I got perturbed, so I just stopped, and then the dog got scared and ran away. Right? And you see that. That's how Ravana was. Ravana, who's lifting Kailash, like a scared dog, because he finally ended being inferior. And he wasn't appreciative of his own wife. He's comparing, right? I need someone else's wife. And what's fascinating about that is he's never even seen Mother Sita. All he heard of her was from Shurpanakha. Gossip is very dangerous, isn't it? Then if you take a sattvic person, what is their relationship with comparing? They just compare themselves to themselves. What their present potential is to their actual potential, their infinite potential. And Vibhishana was great for that, wasn't he? He always wanted to be closer to Lord Rama, closer to Lord Rama, and finally he was able to, physically, mentally, intellectually. And how does someone who's crossed the gunas relate to comparison? No comparison in Advaita, in oneness, exactly. Lord Rama, he's past the gunas. What comparison? So Sanatana Dharma is very much about training. And this training manifests as sadhana. In a corporate sense, we would call it training, and we'd think it's all important and charge lots of money for it. But it's just sadhana. What is continued professional development? Sadhana. What's a PD day? Sadhana day. This is what makes the world move. Now, for us specifically, we are studying sadhana subjectively so that we can reach the subject. There is only the one who knows. That is the subject, and everything else is an object. You are the subject. Have you all seen the movie The Truman Show? In The Truman Show, there's only one non-actor. Everyone else is an actor. But that's in this game of Maya. For us, we're the other way around. We are the only subject. We are the only non-actor, and everyone else is an actor. We are learning to identify with the subject from the champion of Advaita. Vedvyasa can be known as the father of Vedanta, even though he's not the founder. I didn't say founder, I said father. Okay, the one who created this foundation. And Acharya Shankara is the champion of it. He's the one who protected and promoted Advaita. And another word for Advaita is Abhaya. What does Abhaya mean? Fearlessness. Advaita Abhayam. So you and I are studying how to be fearless. Yesterday we took up our 17th sadhana. That's a whole lot of sadhanas. And that was to reflect on the words, the meanings of the scriptures, of the Upanishad. What was our 17th practice? Go for a freedom walk. We have to get into the habit of doing Vyashti Mananam to take us to Samashti Mananam. Try to tune into these words. Vyashti means specific. Samashti means general. If you're able to do Vyashti, focused Mananam, like on a freedom walk, then as you're washing dishes, what will you have the habit to do? Reflect. When you're bathing, what will you have the habit to do? Reflect. But if you don't do it in a specific way, it will never evolve to a general way. Japa is the same way. If you do japa specifically, one mala in the morning, let's say, then you'll naturally do it for the rest of the day also. This freedom walk is Vyashti Mananam. You don't do it with any agenda. You're just walking. Shuti Shiraf Paksha Samashriyatam, which is to follow, to flow with the perspective of the Upanishad. What was our practice for number 18? Be still for at least, or start with, 10 minutes. If you can still your body, it's conducive to stilling your mind. If you can still your mind, it's conducive to stilling your intellect. If you can still your intellect, you can start to experience your nature. Right before Bhagavan Krishna teaches the Stita Prajna Lakshanas in chapter 2 of Srimad Bhagavad Gita, he tells Prince Arjuna, when your intellect becomes stunned, that's when you will come to know who an enlightened person is. So just be still. And as you come to practice contemplation, you're going to want to move your knee and scratch your neck, and the person beside you is going to be breathing too loud, and on and on and on. Remember, that thought flowed in, and since it flowed in, it has to flow out. If you own a thought, you have to act on the thought. But if you observe a thought, you do not have to act on that thought. We have to train ourselves to be more observant of the outer world, then we learn to be more observant of the inner world. Remembering details, remembering people's names, not forgetting where you put things, not forgetting ideas, that level of observation. You see that with Gurudev, correct? I was reading that a gentleman was driving Gurudev to Bhiksha. And the driver, the person who was looking after Gurudev, was talking to him, had a question for him. And he had just completed his question when they got to the home where Bhiksha was supposed to happen. So Gurudev right away got out and they went through whatever they needed to. And after that, Bhiksha had to go to the airport. So this gentleman felt bad that, you know, he didn't get a chance to hear the answer to his question. Next year, when that person went to pick up Gurudev from the airport, as soon as he sat in the car. So, going on with your question from last year, and started answering it. Imagine where he would have gone in that 1 year, and still, he was so observant to pick up with that answer. It's not just observation, it's love. Anything you love, you take interest in. So, the point here is to be observant of when you are quiet, and to be observant that that's coming from your nature. One more thought related to this practice is keep an open mind. Yesterday, Swamiji and I were talking about how when we were kids, there's certain foods you don't like, and then as you get older, you end up liking those foods. But when you're younger, you're emphatic that I do not like this. Like broccoli as an example. But now I think everyone loves broccoli. Do you all love broccoli? Yeah. I do. But when you grew up, you didn't like broccoli. So the same thing will go with understanding the scriptures. So keep an open mind. Dustarkat suviramyatam, which is to let go. And each of these instructions is fully. Not let go halfly, but fully. Poor logic. Argumentation. What was our practice for number 19? Eat a meal by yourself. Are you doing that? Just because you're with other people doesn't mean that you have to engage them. Please remember that. That's that whole social, you're socially awkward, awkward silence. It's a mind game. You can be with people and not be with people. You can be people's friends and not, you can be friendly with people and not be their friend. That's a sign of strength, not weakness. Anyways, here, what we focused on is to be clear, to have clarity about what your purpose is. Clarity evolves to conviction, and conviction evolves to confidence. I interact with a lot of people. I interact with a lot of you. And my observation, getting to know someone more intimately, is confidence is a rare quality in people. We are all insecure in ways that we hide, ways that are obvious but we don't admit to it. And I'll tell you the reason is because we're not convinced. And we're not convinced because we're not clear. As simple as, why shouldn't you fly into Delhi in the wintertime? In January? Fog. Even if it's a Dreamliner, you steal all of that $1 million equipment, you cannot land that plane. There's no clarity. As soon as the sun comes out, clarity comes. Pilots have conviction, they have confidence, everyone moves. Clarity. If you're around unclear people, like right now, no conviction, no confidence. Number 20, which is anusandhiyatam, you should understand, you should engage not the poor logic of people, but the sound logic of the Shastra. What is the 20th practice? Start a spiritual guide. When Sheila gave me this, her old phone, and she took the new phone that I was entitled to, what came with Sheila's new phone? What came with it? Headphones? A user's manual, correct? When I bought this thermos, which is just a vessel, what came with it? There was a user's manual inside, right? Wash before you use this. Read the instructions before you use this. Anything that's created has a user's manual that has come with that creation. Phone, water bottle, car, your clothes. Don't wash this with, you know, mixed colors. Now, this is creation too. And this has come with the user's manual also. What do we call that user's manual? Veda. The Veda is a user's manual. If you want prosperity, study the Karmakanda. You want peace, study the Jnanakanda. The user's manual is made by the creator. Who's better at teaching us how to use that material other than the one who created it, correct? Tim Cook is the CEO of Apple right now, correct? Do any of us know more about this phone than him? Don't say yes. We already said give up pride, or that's that's coming. User's manual. See the practicality of this. Brahmasmiti vibhavyatam. If you sit outside of Swamiji's kutya, there's a small plaque that says, I think it says, keep the bhav, right? Keep the feeling. Here, you should keep the feeling that you are Brahman. What is our practice for this? Nama Rupa Satta. Did you do that today? Good, Yatris. I see the Yatris have done it more than the students. Nama Rupa Satta. And that applies to all. Start with yourself. Name, form, Satta. Think about your form. Do you remember how much you weighed in high school? And now, right? The form keeps changing. You remember when you had really thick hair, really black hair? Now, some of you don't have hair. Some by choice, some not by, by choice. Which form are you? And name. I was telling one of the Yatris that Sheila never calls me Vivek. And they're like, that person wasn't married or, you know, wasn't in that frame of mind. So they're like, what does she call you? I was like, so many names, right? Some good, some bad. Which name am I? But you're always the same Satta. Starting the course, ending the course, starting the discourse, ending the discourse, the same Satta. When you woke up this morning, did you have to remind yourself that you're this particular body? That's how deeply and naturally you have to feel that you're Brahman. A lot of work to do, isn't it? But once you feel that as naturally about Brahman, that doesn't go away. So it's worth it. Aharahar garvav parityajyatam. Give up completely pride. And you will lose, so do it again. And you'll lose again, so do it again. This, when they use this twice, it means incessantly, perpetually. Not just twice, then I give up. I only said it twice. Forever. And what was our practice for this? Eating, using the Pancharina tradition. Did you do it? Good. Very nice. There was once a great minister. His name was Rahim. Have you heard of Rahim? Not Rumi, Rahim. And he was a very generous minister. Whenever people would come to him, he would look straight down and put his hands straight up like this. You know, if someone's coming to you and it seems like you're the greater person and the giver is lesser. And that's how he would give, like this. And Goswamiji, Tulsidasji, found out about this. And Tulsidasji, you know, pure people know pure people. He knew why he was doing this, but their sattvic joy was he wrote him a letter saying, why do you give like this? Are you confused? Your hands are as high as your eyes are low. You know, they talk in poetry like that. And Rahim was very happy that Goswamiji is developing this relationship. And this is what Rahim wrote back. The giver is someone else, giving day and night, but the world gives me the credit, so I lower my eyes. Deep, so deep, that he's acknowledging, like I said, acknowledging, opposite of arrogance, that he's giving what the Creator has created, right? He's giving to the Creator, but people are giving him that credit. There's no room for pride. Someone had once asked me, a new person to Chinmay Mission, how do you feel when people touch your feet? And I told them, I don't know that people touch my feet. It's just, when that happens, physically my eyes may see it, but mentally I'm not registering it. All I'm registering is the Guru Shishya Parampara, finally to Narayana. You've heard me say Narayana when this is happening. Because I'm that dust in someone's pocket. In the Guru Shishya Parampara's clothing, I'm the dust particle that's in that pocket. Like in Horton Hears a Who, I'm that. There's no room for that. And if you think there's room, you're wrong. A rule of thumb here, if you think you're being egotistical, you are. Otherwise, why would you think of that doubt, correct? Finally, the last two. Dehe ham mati rujyatam. Everything here is about giving up. But where do you give up? Sannyasa is not the garb of the body, it's the garb of the mind. Swami Chinmayananda has taught that. Suppose it was literally giving up the body. How will you do sadhana then? Isn't it? You have to give up with your mind that you are more. To let go of this idea that aham is this deha. What was our practice for this? Yes, as you're touching your body. To not touch your body unless there's a purpose. He's scratching his eye. You know, that's different. You have something in your eye. Vivekji told me not to touch my eye. Without a purpose, don't touch your own body. Our blood service in Canada is called Canadian Blood Service, CIS, and they have a very awesome saying, it's in you to give. Blood is in you to give. And they're right. For a person of my height and weight, I have around 8 pints of blood. A pint is approximately 450 milliliters. They take one away with a donation. Prior to going to the course, I donated my blood like 40 times because I thought, they're right, it's in me to give. I'm healthy, I can do this. After the course, because I go to Bharat every year, it's not possible. So 1 pint they take out, it takes 8 weeks for it to come back. So for any healthy person, it's actually good. Makes your body work harder. It's like danam. Blood danam. Blood donation, right? It's a yajna. And in Bharat, for those people from Bharat, they won't operate on someone till you replenish that blood bank. We had a student who had to go through heart surgery. He needed 6 units of blood. 6 of us had to go donate blood before they would operate on him, irrespective of money or connection or whatever. The blood bank has to stay the same. So this body, para upakara, paropakara, this body is to serve others. Physically with blood, more so by helping. And you're able to see that firsthand in this ashram, correct? It's so hot, it's so wet, so many mosquitoes. But people are helping. Why? Because paropakara. Buddha janer vadav parityajyatam. Again, let go of arguing with wise people. What was our practice here? Prostrate to anyone who's wiser than you. So who should you prostrate to? Everyone. That's what Goswamiji says. Everywhere I look, I only see Sitaram. So he's prostrating to the dust particles, to the trees, to the flowers. He just sees them. If you see everyone as wiser than you, giving up pride will be so easy. But you know what our problem is? We are attached. What are we attached to most? Our own ideas, our own opinions, our own messages, and so on and so forth. It's not even this body. Subtler than that is ego. I mean, we're attached to our ideas. That's why wise people, they're able to dismantle that you're really not that wise. That's why it's great to be around wise people, and we're afraid of it, actually. My parents, a resident acharya, his name is Swami Gangeshananda. And he was telling me when I went to visit that a lot of people don't come to meet Swami Subodhananda. Swami Subodhananda is one of the most learned people in our Chinmay Mission acharyas. Scholarly. Like Swami Advayananda, for those who have met him. Okay? Scholarly. And the reason for that is because he's so learned, they're afraid they'll ask him. He'll ask them a question. You know, what does this say about this? Or what does this say about this? And people can't feel like, I don't know. That humiliation is very, not that they should feel humiliated, but it's very hard, isn't it? So jokingly, he says, people surround themselves with foolish people. Because then you always feel good, right? Here, I can make a joke, but I'm not going to. What? I didn't say anything. We continue to verse 4. This is our food verse. For some people, it's not a universe, it's a food verse. You're not laughing, Bandaji. Come on. Kshudvyadischikitsyatam pratidinam bhikshaushadam bujyatam. Swadannam natu yachatam vidivashat praptena santushyatam.
Swadannam natu yachatam vidivashat praptena santushyatam.
Shitoshnadi vishahyatam natu vrita vakyam samuchayatam. Audasinyama bipsyatam janakripa naishturyam utsrijyatam.
Good, your chanting is much better than day one. We start with our 25th sadhana, kshud vyadi chikitsyatam. Kshud here means hunger, vyadi means disease, chikitsyatam, you should get it treated. Chikitsalaya means hospital, means clinic. Go get hunger and disease treated. Okay, from the perspective of the shastra, from the perspective of a sadhu, what is being shared here? Adhi, that's long A-D-H-I, means affliction. It means agitation, disturbance. Where do adhis take place? In the mind. That's why adhi is another word for mental illness. Okay? If there's an adhi, it tends to get expressed as through the body, and that's called a vyadhi. A physical illness is called vyadhi. That is amazing that our rishis knew to separate mental illness and physical illness in that level of detail. Adhi and vyadhi. Here, vyadhi is brought out, this physical agitation. And Acharya Shankara is saying here that hunger causes this. Hunger causes this agitation. And what you should do is treat this agitation like a disease. If anyone's ever been unwell, seriously unwell, and you have to go for serious treatment, do you go in for more treatment than you need to? Do you go in for less treatment than you need to? More or less may hurt you. It may not resolve that matter. You go in for exactly what you need, nothing more, nothing less. Hunger should be treated the same way. Give hunger nothing more and nothing less. If you give too much food, it hurts you. If you give too little food, it doesn't protect you then. This you have to, from an adhyatmic perspective, you have to take this not just to food. Anything that you input, you should treat objectively. Do not give anything undue importance. Don't give it too little importance either. We often hear about dhanam, you know, be generous. But don't be generous at the cost of you not being able to give more in the future, correct? Rock and roll stars sing about the opposite. Neil Young is famous where he sings, "It's better to burn out than fade away." And though he's a great singer, that's not true. You should be in this for the long run, which means that you need to be objective. You need to give the right amount of importance to hunger. how much of the world's health issues would change if people took up this practice. At a sadhana level, what are we going to do? You should be unaware of your stomach. You should be unaware that you even have a stomach. You should never feel hungry. You should never feel full. Your stomach should just be there. Don't allow yourself to fall into hunger. Don't allow yourself to fall into fullness. I was in a home in Bharat, and they had those steel cabinets, and they always have those corny sayings, you know, 10 things you should do at home, or, you know, dance like no one is watching, and all of those kind of things. So I was reading through this, and point number 6 really caught my attention. It was very thoughtful. Rarely do we regret under-eating. Rarely do we regret under-eating. We forever regret overeating, but we keep doing it, correct? Here, we know where our meals are coming from, when they're coming, and on and on and on. So just eat objectively, okay? Be unaware of your stomach. And for all of the people who are leaving this ashram, I think a good way to do this is to keep fruits and nuts with you. Whenever you're feeling hungry, just eat some fruits and nuts. You go back to zero. Okay? Don't allow yourself to be full or hungry. Otherwise, what you're doing is you're creating an upadhi. What does upadhi mean? Limitation. Adhi means affliction. Upa means you're sitting near that affliction. You've made that stomach more real than it is. Pratidinam bhikshaushadam bhujyatam. Bhujyatam means satisfy, exhaust. With aushadam. Aushadam, medicine. The medicine of bhiksha, when? Pratidinam. Every day. So the meaning here is, when does hunger come? Well, only on Friday evenings, because there's going to be good food tonight. When does hunger come? At least 3 times a day. At least. So that's the pratidinam. So you have this disease that is hunger, so the food should be treated as medicine. Looking at this from a Shastra's perspective, a Brahmana, and everyone here is a Brahmana is someone who studies Brahman and shares Brahman. In other words, they make Brahman a focus. Such people do not make food and or funds a focus. It is studying and sharing. When studying and sharing is their focus, then they're not tending to food and funds actively, so they go out for bhiksha. When you go to someone's home for bhiksha and they give you food, that bhiksha is for the present disease, your present hunger. And as you leave someone's home, what else did they give you? Dakshina. Dakshina is for your future hunger, your future disease that's going to come, isn't it? Because you're not tending to your food, you don't know when it will come next. So funds are a modern day of saying, this is for your future meals. We use these terms very strangely. We're going to do dakshina now. Dakshina has become a verb. You offer dakshina. You offer bhiksha in the form of foods. You don't offer bhiksha, here's an envelope. Oh, you're going to eat that now. You offer bhiksha, you offer dakshina. Now, brahmanas, traditionally, they would go with a kamandalu, a dried out pumpkin squash. You see, Lord Shiva carries a kamandalu. And they go to each home and they say, bhiksham dehi, please give me food. And so someone gives rice, someone gives eggplant, someone gives roti, someone gives coconut ice cream, right? And in this kamandalu, there's not sections, like a plate. This is where the ice cream goes. Put it right there. Put the yogurt over here. It all just goes in one compartment, like those cheap plates, right? They have the compartmentalized plates, which cost too much. So they have those simpler ones. And you know what some brahmanas do? They take their kamandalu, there's a handle there, and they go over to a sacred river and dip it in there. And all of the flavor washes away. All of the texture washes away. Hard stuff becomes soft. Watery stuff becomes more watery. And then they sit down and eat. Because they just need nourishment, correct? They're not eating for taste, they're eating for nourishment. Awesome, awesome, awesome. Tough love. But it's not that tough, it makes you tough. That's what you have to remember. The love part is the emphasis, and someone loves you more if they make you stronger, correct? If someone makes you weaker, they don't love you. They're taking you for granted. From an adhyatmic perspective, how many purusharthas are there? How many purusharthas are there? How many purusharthas are there? One. What is the only purusha artha? Moksha. Purusha means purnatva. The one who is full. The meaning of fullness. What is going to make you full? Only freedom. Is education going to make you full? You're all educated. Here you are. Is dharma artha money or funds going to make you full? Is pleasure going to make you full? Only peace can make you full. Daily take the medicine of bhiksha food subjectively means there is only one purpose, only one artha. It may be compartmentalized into four, but there's only one, just like the Veda. There's only actualization. If you study Maslow's hierarchy of needs, there's only actualization. When you look at a pyramid, don't you just look at the top? You don't look at the middle of a pyramid, correct? In Jenga, who wins? You measure it from the top. You don't measure it from the bottom. It's just the top. For us, it's just the deepest. Your practice for 26. Use the internet with an agenda. Use the internet with an agenda. So you use the internet, you finish your work, and you sign off. You close your laptop. What do we do? That's a very strange word. Surf the web. I never understood that phrase. What do you do when you surf the web? But it's not really surfing the web. It's just a game of distraction. When I was posting my rad this morning, then there's a column that says, so many 100,000 people are talking about whatever. Okay? So my eyes drifted to that, so it said 140,000 people are talking about Nicole Kidman. So I clicked it. I'll be 140,001. And so then they had all of these articles about how Keith Urban, her husband, is an alcoholic and how she's working with him for 10 years. I was like, whoa, this is pretty interesting. Let's see what else. Then I clicked. And then who knows where my time went, right? And I realize I'm surfing the web, but I'm actually drowning in the web, correct? There's no surfing that's happening. People are making money off of my distraction. And I'm getting nothing out of it. Who's Keith Urban? I don't know. Nicole Kidman doesn't make movies anymore, right? What does this have to do with anything? But people get lost. They spend hours on Facebook. Hours just, you know, many of our, I don't want to say many, but some of our Balavir students, Yuvakendra, they've just been surfing the web at night and they've come across evangelical Christian websites. And I know three specific cases, you may know these people too, who have become evangelical Christians just from randomly seeing a website. You know, like people get radicalized by radical websites. It happens. I know them. I've met them so many times and they openly tell me their families are pagans, they're going to hell. I keep thinking, what about me then? So use the internet with an agenda. And extrapolate. Go shopping with a list. and on and on and on. Clear? That's what's being shared here. Live at a need level, not at a want level. The internet is another samsara. The ocean of samsara, the ocean of the internet. It is, it's tough to grow up right now. Really. I grew up when the internet was coming out. Remember, you had to get that phone cable from somewhere and drag it, those 50-foot wires, reach behind the desktop that's as big as this thing, plug it in, no one else can use the phone. And there's no websites, there's just chat rooms, right? So you're just chatting away like, yeah, I'm using the internet. What did you learn? Nothing. Now, I'm talking to Swamiji again, the reason that they're not interested in opening up a residential school is they just can't monitor Wi-Fi. You just don't know what someone will do with Wi-Fi in their room at night. In class, sure, but you just don't know. It's a samsara. Samsarati, which means that which slips away. Like a tide, right? You don't know that riptide will just pull you away. But you have to go in the water for that to happen. Some of you don't know how that feels. Your one chance to go in the water yesterday. And still, you were sitting on the rocks. Did I say that out loud? Swadannam natu yachatam. Yachatam means don't beg. For what? Swad. What does swad mean? Tasty annam. Do not beg for tasty food. Tasty nutrition. Right? Nutrition is nutrition. It's not taste. This is untasty nutrition. It's nutrition. Okay. From the perspective of the Shastra. Okay. I have a copy of Bhagavad Gita here. Srimad Bhagavad Gita. What does a chariot symbolize? Body. What do the reins symbolize? Mind. What do the horses symbolize? And what do the road or path symbolize? Sense objects, right? Where else are the senses going to go but the sense objects? How many horses are there?
Four.
Very good. There's four horses. You can't have a chariot with an odd number of horses. The tongue is taste and touch. Okay, four horses. Taste and touch is the tongue. In this equation, body, reins, horses, path, who's the boss in all of this? The chariot is the boss? Out of these four, I only gave you four. Who's the boss? The horses? Reins? Let's have a vote. I like doing these votes. Okay. How many of you believe the sense objects, the road is the boss? How many of you believe the horses, the sense organs are the boss? How many of you believe the chariot, the body, is the boss? How many of you believe the mind, the reins, are the boss? Notice how I put that at the end. The mind is the boss. There is no taste on the tongue, in the tongue. Taste is in the mind. So here, though we talk about not begging for tasty food, it's not about the food. You have to go deeper. It's about your mind. In other words, what we need to do is train our mind. So from an adhyatmic level, what is being shared here is train your mind to enjoy all. Enjoy all. How Guruji shares this, you know the philosophy of eat, drink, and be merry. You've all heard that before. Such people, their lives are about eating and drinking, but they're rarely merry. Guruji says you have to learn to be merry first. If prior to coming here, you got into an argument with the person living in the room next to you, or your roommate, if you're living with someone, you got in an argument about how you're the better student than they are. So you're here, and then afterwards, we eat coconut ice cream. As we're eating coconut ice cream, and it's very good. Today someone had asked Swamiji, should we have coconut ice cream for lunch right now? And Swamiji says, yes. I said, good, I had it for breakfast too. If you're eating that coconut ice cream, but you're thinking about that argument, how does the ice cream taste? Bad, if you taste it at all, correct? This is just functionality, but your mind is not there. The same goes with drinking. You can drink the most delicious fresh coconut water. I don't know why this is with me. I'm leaving soon. You can feel my my anxiety. But if you're thinking about someone who's not well, you received word that someone is not well, then what coconut water, right? It's the same as any water. But for someone whose mind is cool, shama, anything you give them will be great, isn't it? That's why I keep saying the mind is the boss. Our practice for number 27, 1/3 of your meal, each and every meal should be natural. You can replace the word natural with raw if you want to understand that more. 1/3 of your meal should be natural and or raw, uncooked. In other words, the way it came from the ground is the way that you're putting it in you. And this will be ideal training to train your mind to enjoy this part. Because the cooked part will be tasty, isn't it? Spices going in, things coming out. But the raw food is how nature intended for that to be. They have those cave people diets, correct? Where you're only supposed to eat raw food. I'm not saying go to that extent, just 1/3 of your meal. Here it's better. That's a great part about living in an ashram. Here's some great things about living in an ashram. You eat food and not food products. Granola bar, food or food product? It's a food product, isn't it? Chocolate? Eating cocoa is food. Eating chocolate is a food product. We don't eat food anymore, but in an ashram you get food 3 times a day. For people who travel, I eat such horrendous food. It's sad. Like when I sometimes think about myself eating food in the airport, and I make myself sad just thinking about it. But I just have nothing. I can't eat the meat, obviously. And there's lineups for everything else. There's nothing. So you just live on granola bars and protein shakes, and that's just food products. So that's one thing. Another is, you get to actually see the pattern of the sun rising and the sun setting, isn't it? You never get to do that outside of the ashram. And more specifically, is you get to see the phases of the moon. You always get to see all 28, you know, days and then back. That's amazing to be able to do that. Living in an ashram is precious. 1/3 of your meal should be natural, and you will study later on in Tattvabodha. If you eat an apple, the tamasic part of this apple, you will defecate, you will urinate, you will get it out of your body. The rajasic part becomes your body, and the sattvic part becomes your mind. So the more natural food you eat, the more natural your mind will be. In other words, it'll be cooler then. You will be cool. You weren't before you came here, but here you will learn how to be actually cool. This is a cool course. Number 28. This is a very important one. Number 28. Vidivashat praptena santushyatam. Tushti means to be healthy. Tushti, pushti. Santushti, content. The word santosh. Praptena, whatever comes. Vidivashat, whatever comes by fate, whatever comes by this multiverse, you should be content with what comes. That's the message here in 28. From the perspective of the Shastra. Have you ever seen Lord Rama's family picture? You know, people take cruise pictures and Christmas pictures. He also, their Ram Darbar, right? That's their family picture. So how does Lord Rama look in his family picture? Feet are straight, legs are straight, torso is straight, arms are straight, head is straight, bow is straight. He's in his family picture with his bow. You know, you haven't seen your wife for so long. She kind of puts her head towards you. You put your head, he's straight. Completely straight. And completely smiling. Have you ever seen Lord Krishna's picture? Completely crooked. Feet are crooked, ankles are crooked, knees are crooked, hip is crooked, shoulders are crooked, fingers are crooked, elbows are crooked, neck is crooked, smile is crooked, peacock feather is crooked. Everything about him is crooked. Curved. I should say curved again. That Lord Krishna is a crooked fellow. He's curved and he's also completely smiling. Which teaches us, if life is straight, smile. If life is curved, smile. That saying, life throws you a curveball, came from Bhagavatam. Be content. And I keep trying to highlight, it's not hard to be content. We have to allow ourselves to be content. From an adhyatmic perspective, please tune into this. If you work hard for something you want and you get it right away, the Creator bestows it upon you right away. What is the Creator trying to teach you? To be grateful. Very good. Be grateful. If you work hard for what you want and it doesn't come right away, it comes after a period of time that you wanted it sooner, but it came after a period of time. What is the Creator trying to teach you? To be patient or peaceful. I'm just trying to play on the word full, okay? Great, full. Peace, full. If you work hard for what you want, but you don't get it, it does not come into your spectrum. What is the Creator trying to teach you? To be faithful. Be faithful that the Creator knows better. That you didn't need that. Something better will come for you. Whether that means nothing, that could also be the context. Grateful, peaceful, faithful. In either way, whatever comes to you or doesn't come to you, it's for your best. Bhagavan's blood bleeds love. You know, they say that he bleeds blue or bleeds whatever. You know, it's sports teams. Bleeds love. So that shows that every facet of Bhagavan is love. So everything that comes to you is from the perspective of love. And just because you don't understand it doesn't make it unloving. Right? Those youngest Balavir students, if they were allowed to choose their meals for the day, they would ask for cereal four times a day, correct? Trix in the morning, frosted flakes for lunch, etc., etc., etc. But those parents don't allow them to eat cereal four times a day. Good parents don't allow them to eat cereal four times a day. And those kids say, you're the worst parents. But those parents don't care about those words. Right? They love those kids. So eat one third of your meals natural. From an adhyatmic perspective, whatever is in your life or out of your life, be content. It is all stane. Tomorrow I'll talk about stane. Stane means perfect. It is all perfect. And to make this a little bit more concrete, name some of Lord Shiva's names. Shankara, Ashutosh. Good, we got it right away. Ashutosh means the one who is easily pleased. Lord Krishna references this in Srimad Bhagavad Gita. Patram? What does patram mean? Leaf. Pushpam? Water. Toyam? Water. With bhakti. Patram is not plural. It's leaf. It's not even tulsi leaf, bilwa leaf. It's leaf. It could be a fallen leaf. Pushpam? It could just be an emoticon. It could be something you, it's something you imagined, right? Mantra pushpam, it could just flower. Shiva manasa puja, Acharya Shankara teaches, you don't need any materials for puja. You just need vrittis, thoughts. Toyam, it could be gutter water if you offer it with bhakti. Bhagavan is easily pleased. And if that's our parent, which he or she is, then we also have to be easily pleased. We are easily displeased. Too hot, we're displeased. Too cold, we're displeased. You should see the bus rides that I've been on. Our sadhana here, sadhana for 28. Before you complain, I want you to do a cost-benefit analysis of whether it's worth complaining or not. What are the costs of complaining? What are the benefits of complaining? You have to do that analysis. And if the benefits are greater than the costs, complain away. And if they're not, keep your mouth closed and your mind open. Okay, cost-benefit analysis of complaining. You know what the secret behind this sadhana is? You would have put so much energy in that cost-benefit analysis, you would have forgotten what you had to complain about. Isn't it? Correct. I had heard somewhere that if you are interacting with a ati-ugra, an extremely angry person, there's the shastric technique. If you're interacting with an extremely angry person, what should you do to them to interact with them? Praise them. Start praising them. You know, I'm really mad at you, and you start saying, your hair looks really good today. Right? That was the best discourse ever. All of a sudden, I forgot about my anger. Please tell me more about, what did you like about this? Correct? Sociologically, I've heard that when someone is arguing with you, someone's very mad, you should start whispering, I'm mad at you too. And if you start whispering, number one, you don't take yourself so seriously, and then that person definitely doesn't take you seriously either. They forget why they're mad at you, right? It's not hard.
So if you whisper, complain, you're all good.
Yeah, whisper. It's so hot outside. Nobody cares. Cost-benefit analysis before you complain. 29. The last four are quite deep. Shitoshnadi vishahyatam. Vishahyatam is another word for endure. Like, what's another word for endure? Tatiksha. What should you do? Shitaha. That which is cold. Ushnaha. That which is hot. Adi, any sort of combination of pairs of opposites. Okay. From the perspective of the Shastra, what does Vairagya mean? What does Vairagya mean? Think, etymology of this. The simpler form of Vairagya is Viraga. What does Viraga mean? Without likes or attachment. The simplest definition of raga is like. Raga is where the Hindi form rang comes from. Rang, we tend to think of red, correct? Raga, rang, red. It's a projection. Likes and dislikes are not intrinsic to anything. If I give you this phone doesn't care. Its owner was Sheila for a long time. Now its owner is me. It doesn't care. But Sheila didn't like this phone. And I also don't like it either. That's coming from us. It is a projection. It is a color. Red is rajas. I like this. What comes with likes? Dislikes. Viraga means without like, which deeply means without projection. Even heat and cold is relative. How many of you are cold right now? How many of you are hot? Fine. Okay. How many of you like the humidity? Unanimously, no. How many of you dislike the humidity? How many of you are okay with it? It's the same humidity on the same, this is called epidermis, right? Same epidermis. The mind is saying, I like this and I don't like this. Skin-wise, we're not that different from each other. Certainly, some people have more sensitive skin, less sensitive skin. But it's more about our projection. So Acharya Shankara here is saying, stop projecting. At a adhyatmic level, why do you need titiksha? Need titiksha. You need titiksha to inquire. Inquiring is hard. And so you need to endure. You need to forbear to be able to inquire. Remember in the churning of the Milky Ocean, what came out? Poison and heat. So much heat came out of that churning. They couldn't bear that heat. That's showing how challenging inquiry is. And you need to have shama. You need to keep your mind cool to go all the way. In chapter 9 of Srimad Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavan says, Saha amritatvaya kalpate, which means for someone who has this titiksha, that person is ready for immortality. But don't isolate the titiksha. That person who's inquiring is ready for immortality. But to inquire, you need to not take dvaita so seriously. Yeah? Okay, practice. 29. You may have heard this riddle from me before, so don't shout it out. It's really annoying when people shout out answers and don't give everyone else a chance, right? It's like riddle culture, isn't it? You sell someone, you have the answer, and you just quietly hold it there. But we're always looking for that pride. I know the answer, I should tell everyone. What four-word phrase, and each word has four letters, all in English. When you say it to a happy person, they become sad. And when you say it to a sad person, they become happy. How many letters in each word?
Four.
How many words in the phrase?
Four.
What language?
English.
Happy person becomes?
Sad
person becomes?
Happy.
How many of you know the answer? Okay, here's your hint. Third word is will. Second word is this. First word is even. Even this will pass. Your sadhana is to remember, even this will pass. When you're feeling it's too humid, even this will pass. After 2 years, but it will pass. When it's snowing outside, even this will pass. In the discourses, even this will even this will pass. And if you really want to make this clear, every day you should tell this riddle to someone else. It's a great way to remember is this, okay? There's lots of visitors. Just each Bali, you know, school child here, tell them. Just grab them and tell them, okay, listen, this is my sadhana. I have to do this. I don't even know you. Number 30. What does Acharya Shankara say? Samuchariyatam vakyam natu vrita, which means you should be mindful, be careful to not get lost in wasteful talking, in gossiping. See what happened to Ravana with gossiping. They should have a poster of this is what happens when you gossip. They have Ravana there. What happens is you get enlightened, right? He merged with Lord Rama. If gossiping will take me there, I'll start gossiping. From the Shastra's perspective, we go to Sri Ramakrishna. A book everyone here has to read now or soon after you complete your studies is called The Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna. The Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna. I, by accident, read this when I had finished high school, and it's helped me a lot. Sri Ramakrishna says, people talk about three things, three fields of our conversations. You tell me what we talk about. Ourselves, people, desires. They all start, Sanskrit words all starting with K. Close enough, kamini. He uses the word kamini, which is pleasure, and kanchana or kanchana, which is possession, gold or possession, and kirti. Kirti, which is position, fame. Kamini, kanchana, kirti. He says this is all people talk about. Kamini, kanchana, kirti. Pleasure, possession, position. From an adhyatmic perspective, I mentioned this to all of you yesterday, to be utterly careful about what you think of. Okay, 2 points here. I'll go to a longer period term first. In Satya Yuga, when our minds were most powerful, for punya, to engage in merit, you had to think it and act it. To get punya in Satya Yuga, you had to think it and act it. So as an example, using a very worldly example of charity, if I want punya, I have to think about giving and I actually have to give punya. Whereas papa, you just had to think it and papa would come. If I needed to hurt someone, just by thinking it, I would incur sin. That's in Satya Yuga. Now we fast forward to Kali Yuga, where we are. Bhagavan is very loving. When it comes to punya, you just have to think it. You do not have to act it. Bhagavan knows how distracted we are. He said, if you can just bring your mind there, good enough. Like extreme consolation prize. Participant. Ribbon. And when it comes to papa, you have to think it and act it. Thank God. Thank God that we have to act it too. What I had heard here was, if we all got what we deserved, we'd all be miserable. But because of this equation, we're doing okay. So when you start thinking about kamini, kanchana, kirti, the point here is if you start thinking it, you're going to start acting it too. Do you all know who Ajamila is? Ajamila was a brahmana. A brahmana studying and sharing the scriptures, just like all of us. And one day he went to the forest to collect flowers for his puja. And who did he see there? Prostitute. He saw another man come, and this prostitute and this man were enjoying themselves, customers. He's there to collect flowers, and he's trying to pick up the flowers, but he just keeps looking at them. He finally collects the flowers, comes home. He's doing his puja. His mind is still over there. He just keeps thinking about this prostitute, so much so that one day he invites her to his house. He's a happily married person. He thought it so strongly that he had to act it out. Avoid wasteful talks. You do not know when that one word will start to poison that field that is your mind. Here is our practice, the sadhana for this. Say no to transactional conversations. Say no to transactional conversations. There's no time to waste. Have fundamental conversations, not transactional ones. For the people who are invited to parties, we go to so many parties that are transactional. They actually don't want you to be there, but you invited them, so they have to invite you. And what do? Without thinking, we just say yes. Learn to say no. And it's a very beautiful change when you start to say no. Soon people don't even invite you. It's great. People don't invite Sheila and I anymore. We don't have to say no anymore. And we're not sitting suffering from FOMO. We're having JOMO, right? Enjoy your song and dance. We are enjoying each other's company, our sadhana. But you'll only say no if you are tuned into the fundamental, correct? You're not tuned into the fundamental. The functional is great then. Nachiketa. He's telling the Lord of Death, Dharmaraja, you keep your song and dance. In other words, you keep your functionality, you keep your transactions, you teach me the fundamental. You teach me the truth. FOMO JOMO, that came from Nachiketa. His father, FOMO. Him, JOMO. Everything comes from the scripture. So unambiguously, it is all sourced from here. 31. There's so many of these abhipsyatam, you know, these long Sanskrit words that we don't know what any of them means, but it's simply saying is do. What should you do? You should be audasina. Audasina. Okay. Audasina means udasina. All of our Hindi speakers, what does udasina mean? Sad. That person's so udas. That person's pankaj udas. Udas doesn't mean sad. Udas means someone who's, I'll tell you the literal meaning, ut asina, the one who's sitting above. That's what udasina means. The one who sits above. From let me go to the Shastra first, sorry. Bhagavan Krishna at one point will say, maya adhyakshena prakritihi. I am the supervisor, the manager of creation. And the implication of that is he manages creation, which means he's not subject to creation. He is udasina. He is sitting above creation. So he's not affected by it. Now from a Shastra's, from an adhyatmic perspective, you and I have to learn to be above creation. And I'll tell you very specifically how to. What is the highest form of ahimsa? Of himsa, not ahimsa. What is the highest form of himsa? Of hurting someone? Conversions. Example. If she comes up here and punches me on the shoulder, it may hurt for some time. Probably not, but it may hurt for some time. If she comes here and starts, you know, distracting all of you, you know, then it will agitate me a little bit. If she leaves here and starts saying bad things about me, that's going to stay with me for a long time, correct? She hurt my body. It's okay. She hurt my mind. Hurts more, but still okay. She hurts my intellect. It lasts much longer because my intellect is much more intimate to me. Converting someone is forcing someone to believe what you believe. It is intellectual violence. Politics is one thing. You see how many friendships broke with this present election in America. Religion is even more intimate. See what happened in 1947. Two countries got freedom, apparently, in 1947. I'm not going to go any further than that. I have lots to say about that, but I'm not going to. I'll ask you first. Why do we take criticism so seriously? Because we take compliments so seriously. We take criticism so seriously because we take compliments so seriously. And that moment when you take compliments more casually, when criticism comes in, you will also take that more casually. In other words, you're starting to sit above this game, this creation. Start with that. Because there's already so many shlokas that, or sadhanas that talk about food and temperature and this and that. Here we pick up intellect. Compliments and criticism. Here is our practice for number 31. When you are indecisive about small matters, flip a coin. Let that coin decide what you're going to do. What that teaches us is to just go with the flow, to adapt. Yesterday when we were deciding which bus to sit on, then I had asked Dvijyoti and Swamiji, I said, what number is behind my hand? You know, I just put random fingers out and I said, okay, if it's this number, you're going to sit there. If it's this number, you'll sit here. That's it. It's not like, show me your hand. How do I know you didn't change your hand? Correct. Sheila and I do this all the time. Where are we going to eat? We'll flip a coin. But if you do this, you have to follow the coin then. You can't flip it. No, we still want to go over there. It's like, you know, there's code of the school ground that you're not supposed to break. This is code of the coin flip. If you flip the coin, then you got to go with that coin flip. And never, when it comes to people, never allow there to be captains. You know, when we make teams, captains is likes and dislikes, isn't it? When you get older, it becomes about who's better or worse. But when you're younger, it's just likes and dislikes. I like that person. I want him on my team. I don't like her very much, right? And then the last people, they're the most disliked people or the least talented people. It's the worst. See how our education system doesn't catch that? You should never have captains. You do things like birthday and height, you know, just very obvious things like that. So it's not personal. You're catching me? I don't know what's more practical than this. We've studied 31 ways to be enlightened. That's what this is. But we keep talking about let's be enlightened, but we don't know how to do it. Like this. Use a coin. Yes, you're giggling. Yes, it's humorous. But I'm not serious for anything else, but now I'm serious. Like, please internalize this. Here, all of you have an opportunity to practice this more, but what do you think is going to happen? Then you're just going to magically become enlightened. You have to live this. And these are 31 ways to integrate this into what you already do. When Arjuna says, I want to leave, what does Lord Krishna say? He looks the other way. He doesn't allow him to leave. Don't change your name. Don't change your form. Don't change your relationships. Don't change anything outside of you but you. Deep message. But we don't, again, we just don't think about it enough. Finally, jana kripa naishturyam utsrijyatam, which means that we should let go, so much like letting go. We should save ourselves from the kripa. Kripa here doesn't mean grace, but kripa means friendliness, the giving of the jana. Do not be indebted to people. That's what's being shared here. Do not be indebted to people. Anger is a effect. What is the cause of anger? I'm taking it from a shastra's perspective, okay? Fear. Krodha comes from bhaya. Fear is an effect. Where does fear come from? Attachment, raga. That is raga, bhaya, krodha. Bhagavan Krishna says, vita raga, be without attachment. But attachment also is an effect. Attachment comes from projection. We're almost there. Projection, which is vikshepa. And projection comes from ignorance, which is avarna. Please study that carefully. Avarna is the cause. Then vikshepa, raga, bhaya, krodha. In English, ignorance, projection, attachment, fear, and anger. This ignorance is that my nature is happiness. I'm ignorant of that. I'm ignorant that I'm complete. From an adhyatmic perspective, when someone is ignorant of their completion, they start to project. They project dvaita, and then on dvaita, likes and dislikes. When someone projects, they get attached. Everyone's following? Avarna, vikshepa, raga. When you're attached to an article, to a material, to something, what would a psychologist call that? It's a addiction. It's an addiction. If I'm attached to coconut ice cream, it's an addiction, correct? If you're dependent on a being, it's called attachment. They're exactly the same. Addiction and attachment are exactly the same. One is more material in nature, one is less material. And because it's less material, we justify it. And when it comes to circumstances, it's called apathy. That you know everything is changing and still you depend on that which is changing. That is apathy. Apathy is different than ignorance. In ignorance, I don't know, so I can't do anything. In apathy, I know and I still don't act wisely. So you and I are lost in addiction to articles, attachment to beings, and apathy to circumstances. Acharya Shankara is sharing here, do not depend on any article, any being, any circumstance. Here he says it lovingly, do not be saved from the kindness of people. More deeply, he's saying, do not depend. Forget about people too. He is saying, do not depend, period. Whatever you put in front of that. I'll give you another way that Lord Krishna says this. When do the teachings of Srimad Bhagavad Gita begin? What chapter? What shloka? 11. Chapter 2, shloka 11. 47 shlokas in chapter 1, 10 shlokas in chapter 2, 57 shlokas just set up. Just identification with the scripture. Shloka 11, he comes with the only message in Srimad Bhagavad Gita, the wise do not grieve. Then, please hold there, he says, for the living nor the dead. That's irrelevant. That's a huge bracketed message. His message is the wise do not grieve. And by example, he says, for the living or the dead. That implies all. They do not grieve. They only smile. Wise people, it's not even they smile outside. We think people who smile a lot are more evolved. They smile within. They're unshaken. So here, Acharya Shankara is saying, do not depend. Swatantra. Vedanta is a subject of swatantra, independence. Sadhana. When we were at the ashram, and I'm only giving you a reference point, someone would tell Guruji, one of the students would tell Guruji that it's my birthday, okay? Just a reference point. And Guruji would say, Me kya karu? What am I supposed to do about that? Because you're learning that you don't have a body, so how can you be born? He says, Me kya karu? Tough love. We should replace it with awesome love. Like, that's awesome love. We'll say happy birthday and, you know, may you be happy forever. He says, you are happiness. You weren't born. Hey, idiot. Na bandaha na muktihi. There's no freedom because you're not bound. When you study Nirvana Shatakam, that will come. On your birthday, our tradition is not to collect, but to distribute. On your birthday, you should give that percentage of your gross income to charity. So if you're 55, 5.5% of your gross income should be given to charity. In that upcoming year, you should have become wiser, so you're going to now give 5.6%. Each birthday you give more, not less. Resources. Now we go to time. On your birthday, whatever percentage of resources you're giving, give half that amount in time to charity. So if I'm 40 years old, I would give 2% of the hours I have in a week to charity. So how many hours a week are there? 168. 2% of 168 is approximately 3 or 4 hours. A week is given to charity. And finally, effort. Effort. Half of that should be given daily to your self-development. So if I'm giving 2 hours a week to charity, I should give 1 hour a day at least to my own effort towards myself. I'm going to explain those equations again, okay? So let's take someone being 40 years old. On their 40th birthday, what percentage of their gross income are they going to give to charity? 4%. And when it comes to time, they're going to give what percentage of their time to charity every week? To charity. So giving resources is a yearly matter. Giving time is a weekly matter. And effort, you give 1% of your effort towards yourself every day. So 1% of your hours in a day, like that. Okay? And my simple point here is as you age, be more giving, not taking. That's the bigger picture of all of this. Let's very quickly go through all of the sadhanas. Looking at me, we've now completed 32. 8 more to go tomorrow. So, number 25 from today. What is the sadhana? Be unaware of, especially now, be unaware of your stomach. Number 26, use the internet with an agenda. And if you don't have an agenda, don't use the internet then. Number 27, one third of your meal should be raw, should be natural. It's much cheaper too. Number 28, before you complain, cost-benefit analysis. Number 29, remembering the message, even this will pass. Number 30, learning to say no to transactional conversations. So if I come to you and say, so,